So we've talked a bit about your background, and we've talked about sort of general approaches. I was very struck by a conversation by Ken Frazo, who heads Merck at the Business Council, probably about a year ago. And everybody was, it was after the killing of, or the murder of George Floyd. And everybody was focused on education, training, conscious bias training, etc. And Ken, he didn't get a chance really to get to what I sensed was his sort of biggest area of interest, or where he thought the most progress could be made quickly. And that was in the area of procurement.
Mm-hmm.
And we've seen, you know, I can remember a pitch that we did with Facebook, which we won. And the reason was that we had, and we're not as virtuous as we should be in these areas, we're getting there, but we have about 40% people of color. Our Afro-American population is too low, and you know, we're making strenuous attempts to increase it. But he, in the Facebook example, 40% of the grade by the CMO and his and her colleagues was around the diversity of the team. And it always struck me, you know, we wouldn't have got to first base, let alone hit a home run, unless we had a diverse team, which we did. Right. So, well, turning to what specifically needs to be done, Robert, I mean, what actions, structural actions, changes? I mean, you talked about it generally. What would you like to see?
It has to be a holistic approach to the ecosystem. And that's, you know, easy to say on the one hand. Now we have to talk about how we get there. It's fundamentally, you have to create access to capital. Okay. You have to create access to opportunity. You have to create, you know, on-ramps to opportunity and engagement. So specifically how I think about it is, and we have learned a lot, 70% of African-American neighborhoods, just to give you a sense, don't have a branch bank. Okay. So now you think about this. If you wanted to go and, you know, buy a house and get a mortgage and you don't have a branch bank, where do you go? Right. And you don't have a banking relationship. And so we have these things called, you know, I call them capillary banks, CDFIs and MDIs, that are under-resourced and under-modernized. So one of the efforts that we've taken on is, okay, let's build systems to modernize the CDFIs and MDIs, and let's build systems to actually bring capital, tier one capital, into those infrastructure, because for every dollar they get in tier one capital, they can lend $8. $8, you know, for one, to for houses, for access to, for small to medium businesses. If you're a small business, you don't have access to a bank, and you know this part, how do you grow? Mm-hmm. Okay, like this InfoScout example, if you didn't have access to go, you know, get $200 million to go buy a company, like you wouldn't be able to go buy it, right? Well, think about, you know, you've got a small business, you need another $30,000 to add another barber chair, another, you know, or add another, you know, five tables to your restaurant, and you don't have a banking relationship to go borrow that money. Then those are one of the areas. So that's kind of point one, access to capital. The second thing, which is as critical in this environment, is access to broadband, to the internet. Why? Because that is the enablement of the future. And we've got, you know, 36% of African-American communities don't have access to broadband, which means those communities, the children during this pandemic, did not have access to remote learning opportunities, which creates a whole nother generational challenge or resonance of being educated. And you've seen the stories and heard them, you know, kids, you know, their parents are, you know, going to the fast food restaurants, sitting outside on the curb where they could actually, you know, tie into the hotspot. So that's one area we're focused on. How do you bring internet capacity? Because once you bring in broadband and internet capacity into these neighborhoods, A, it enables learning management systems, remote learning, distance learning. B, it starts to enable things like telemedicine. So you can actually start to address and treat some of the healthcare disparities in those communities. C, you have the ability to actually deliver now solutions, software solutions, to these small to medium businesses that create, you know, more efficiency in what they do. A small business that implements software solutions has a 900% return on those software solutions. It could be scheduling, it could be booking, it could be accounting, whatever it might be, payroll preparation, whatever it might be. But if you don't enable those businesses, then they won't be able to participate in that next generation of actually current opportunities. You know, the pandemic showed that if you didn't have digital enablement, you were going to suffer disproportionately. And African-American businesses suffered disproportionately. Over 40% of them closed down during this pandemic. Are they going to be able to start up? I don't know. Is there going to be enough capital available? Well, those are the elements we have to focus on. You know, I think about it, education, you know, housing is other. So part of what we are doing in my 2% solution is really saying, all right, corporations, here's the thing. You actually have the capital. Okay, you make enough money that you can actually think about how do I, you know, use parts of that capital to create sustainable infrastructure. You also have the ability to do it. So it isn't as if these carriers don't have the ability or the know-how or the wherewithal to create broadband infrastructure. And I'm just going to talk to the U.S. for the 30,000 Americans who don't have it. Because I've got, you know, one of our friends, Mukesh Ambani, who's connected 420 million people with broadband internet in about 4.5 years. And Mukesh is brilliant. But I think we can connect 1/10 of that, you know, in that period of time as well. You see the point? So yeah. there's structural dynamics, all that. But those are the sorts of things we just have to have the will to get that done, because when you do those sort of things, then you can start to impact and say, let me drive some learning management systems into those communities, which is what we've been doing with one of our companies. Let me drive some modernization capacity into, you know, the banking system so that these CDFIs, MDIs can go to modern banking infrastructure. And there was one group run by a friend of mine, Bill Bynum Hope, you know, this credit union, and he's in the Delta, you know, Mississippi, you know, Georgia, Alabama, and that area, prior to the COVID, was doing 50 to 60 loans a year. When he modernized the infrastructure, he now did 7,500 loans in 9 months, in 3 months. That's the sort of impact you get by modernizing that infrastructure. And then, of course, driving capital through the system. And the average loan, I think, was like $11,000 for a business that had huge impacted 35,000, 40,000, you know, business owners and people.